So welcome to this course on electronic system design. So in fact, in this particular course, we will be discussing about the different types of electronic circuits and its applications in the various fields of engineering and technology. Now to start with, let me have this topic, which is a very familiar one, as far as the understanding in electronics or electrical engineering is concerned, and that is all about the RC circuit. Now, before saying anything about this circuit, so let me just draw a simplified say black box model like this. Suppose my system is kept within that, and we have provided some input in the form of say X, and the output is obtained in the form of say Y. Now this is the system, some electronic system, which accepts the input as X and provides the corresponding output as Y. Now in many occasions we say that the system is linear in nature, or the system is linear. Now, what do you mean by a linear system? That you have to understand at the very beginning. Now, whenever we talk about a linear system, then the theory of superposition must hold good. Perhaps you understand what is meant by the theory of superposition. So linearity, let me just write it down over here. So linearity means it's equivalent to the theory of superposition. And in fact, within linearity, we do have two different components. So let me just identify these two components first. One is known as the additivity. That is the first component of linearity. And the second component is homogeneity. Now, when the system is both additive as well as homogeneous, then we call the system as a linear system. Now, whenever we model the system by means of a black box, so there can be anything within the system. So we can have some analog system. We can also have some digital system. However, the input and output must follow the theory of superposition. So in that sense, we can say that the system is linear in nature. And in fact, in this particular course, we will be dealing with each of these systems, both the analog systems as well as the digital systems. Now, whenever we talk about the additivity and homogeneity, first of all, you have to understand what is the meaning of these two terms, additivity and homogeneity. Now, let me start with the term additivity. What do you mean by additivity? Whenever I can say the system is additive in nature, suppose, let me consider the same system. Suppose the system is identified by some, say, some curly S. And the input to the system is, say, X1. And we get the output to be Y1. Now, if the input is X2 to the same system, suppose the output is Y2. So let me apply just two inputs. One by one, first X1, the output becomes Y1, and then X2, then the output becomes Y2. Now, if you provide a combined input like X1 plus X2, and if the corresponding output is obtained as Y1 plus Y2, if this condition holds good, then only I can say that the system is additive in nature. So let me once again mention whatever I have told a few minutes back. Suppose I am having a system which is identified by some curly S. That means Y1 or Y can be represented as S of X. So it's a function. X is the input to the system and the corresponding output is Y. Now, if for a particular input X1, the output is Y1, and for another input X2, if the output is Y2, then for the input X1 plus X2, the corresponding output should be Y1 plus Y2. Now, if this condition holds good, then I can say that the system is additive in nature. Now, although I have used the term plus over here, but you understand that subtraction is also a kind of addition. So if I say that x1 plus x2 produces an output of y1 plus y2, it inherently means that for an input x1 minus x2, the output is equal to y1 minus y2. So I'm not saying this one explicitly, but that is implicitly taken into account. So that is all about the additive property of a system. Now, what do you mean by the homogeneity? Now, for homogeneity, let me consider the same system. The system is identified by some curly S, and the input to the system is X, and the output is Y. Now, if for an input alpha times X, if the output is given by alpha times Y, for any constant alpha, real constant or imaginary constant, for any constant alpha, if the input is scaled by some factor and the output is also scaled by the same factor, then we say that the system is homogeneous in nature. So these are the two different criteria, and if the system, if any system satisfies each of these two criteria, both additivity and homogeneity, then we can say that the system is linear in nature. So additivity plus homogeneity. So both of these two must be satisfied, and it gives rise to linearity. Now you can find several systems for which the additivity condition holds good, but the homogeneity condition doesn't hold good, and the vice versa. And you can also find some system for which neither additivity or nor homogeneity holds good. So in that case, we cannot say the system is linear. So you can only say the system is linear when both the additive and the homogeneous property are getting satisfied. So with this brief introduction about the linearity, which suggests that the theory of superposition must be valid for those circuits. Now, first of all, you have to identify some of the circuit elements which must follow this additivity property. Now, to start with, let me just consider. I'm not writing the or I'm not drawing the circuit.
Hello.
Circuit element.
Hello, sir.
Any doubt?
Hello. Sir, I have one doubt, sir. From the sir, why you have written that y equal to that is function of s? Sorry. S of X, from where it comes, sir?
Okay, let me just go back to this slide. So I am modeling the system by means of some function, because as you understand, the output of the system basically depends upon the system property and obviously the input to the system. That is true for any system. The output of any system Y basically depends upon
yes.
the input
sir.
Of the system and the property of the system.
Sir, now, I am going
to model the system by means of some function, right? And that function is represented by some is. Now, whenever we explicitly explore the system property, then you find that what is this particular function. For example, I can also have a simple voltage divider circuit over here inside the system, consisting of two different resistances like R1 and R2. Then you can explicitly find out the relation, or you can explicitly write down what is the expression for Sx, right? So in order to give your answer, let me just take you example. Suppose, once again, let me just represent the system by means of curly S. The input to the system is X and the output to the system is Y. Now, if the system is additive as well as homogeneous, then you must admit that for an input alpha 1 X1 plus alpha 2 X2, the output should be alpha 1 y1 plus alpha 2 y2, where x1 where for input x1 the output becomes y1, and for input x2 the output is y2. So these are the individual input output combination. Now if the system is linear in nature, then for an input alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2, the corresponding output will be alpha 1 y1 plus alpha 2 y2. Now I did not write anything inside this black box. I have only represented this black box by means of some function like s, right? And I have mentioned that okay, this y is given by this function s of x. Okay, now there should be some element inside this black box which is modeled by this s. Now what could have been the possible elements so that this this condition holds good? Now let us take a very familiar and very simpler circuit diagram. For example, let me consider that this is a two port network. It's a two port network for which the input is say v1, and suppose the output is say v2. Not necessarily that your input and output, both of them are voltage or both of them are current. Sometimes your input could have been voltage, output could have been current, and vice versa. Now here, for the sake of analysis, let us assume that the input and output, both of them are voltage, and the input voltage is given by V1 and the output voltage is given by V2. I do not know what is there inside this black box. Now suppose I have to model the system in such a way that the system must follow the theory of superposition. The principle of superposition must hold good. Now let us try to populate the element, or rather elements. By means of two resistances, just like this. Suppose this is the system R1 and R2. So then you can, if you just simply apply the voltage divider law, then it will be nothing but V2 is nothing but R2 upon R1 plus R2 into V1. So V2, that is your output output voltage. So you can write, instead of writing V2, I can write V2 as, so this is your output voltage, or rather output. So this is equivalent to Y, as we mentioned earlier. That is equal to, given by some R1, some R2 upon R1 plus R2 times V1. So can you recognize this entire thing, R2 upon R1 plus R2 into V1 as a function of input? Yes, because this entire thing depends upon the input as well as the system property. It depends upon the individual value of R1 and R2 as well as the input to the system. So can I write this as some S into X? Or in other words, can I write V2 as some S of V1? Yes, we can. How this S of V1 defined? S of V1 is given by R2 upon R1 plus R2 into V1. So depending upon the circuit elements and depending upon their arrangement inside the black box, we can have different types of those functions. And all of these functions are generically being represented by means of this curly S, so that it can identify system, nothing else. So S stands for systems. So that's why I've written like S. So you can, if you want, you can also write in terms of F. If you want, you can also write in terms of G. So that is a matter of representation and nomenclature. So I can write this as a function of, or output as a function of input. And this function is being represented by this particular thing, that is S, because it stands for system. Now for this very simple circuit, you have to understand whether this the circuit that I have drawn over here, that I have designed over here, whether or not it satisfies the additivity and homogeneity property together. That means whether the system is linear or not, that you have to understand, that you have to verify. Now how to verify it? You know that if V1 is the input, so let me Okay, let me just mark it over here only. Suppose I provide two different input. Say one is say let it be V1 dashed, and second one is say V1 double dashed, and the corresponding output say let this be V2 dashed and V2 double dashed. Then you can easily write it down. What is the relation between V2 dashed and V1 dashed? So V2 dashed is equal to if I represent this entire thing R2 by R1 plus R2 as some factor. Say let me write R2 by R1 plus R2. Let me call this factor as K. So I can write V2 dashed is equal to K times V1 dashed, and V2 double dashed is equal to same K times V1 double dashed. Now if I provide an input say alpha times V1 dashed plus beta times V1 double dashed, then what will be the corresponding output voltage? The corresponding output voltage is nothing but alpha time V2 dashed plus beta times V2 double dashed. That means the law of superposition gets satisfied in this particular circuit. So we can say that the circuit is linear in nature, and that is intuitively true because we are dealing with a circuit that is composed of resistance only. So let me just consider the circuit elements one after another. So the circuit element which is there at our hand is nothing but a simple resistance. And as you know, if you just draw the current voltage characteristics of a resistance, so this is a resistance R, and if I apply a voltage difference say V, and then if the corresponding current is I, then you know what is the relation between this V and I. V is equal to R. So that is the well-known Ohm's law. So V is equal to R into I, or you can write I is equal to 1 by R times V. So the current is the excitation and the voltage is the corresponding stimulus. So if I consider there is a resistance, and if you apply a voltage difference between the two terminals of resistance, then obviously there will be current flow through the resistance, and the current that is flowing through the resistance is proportional to the applied voltage. That is the fundamental idea behind the Ohm's law, and accordingly we can understand that the resistance is basically a linear device. Because if you just consider once again the VI characteristics, then it's something like that for a resistance. So therefore, whenever we have a resistance in a circuit, then the individually the input to the to this particular element and the corresponding output, they follow this property that the output and output and the input, they are related by means of this function. So accordingly, we can say that the resistance is a linear device. That is the first thing. Now the second thing is that whenever we talk about this law of superposition, that means the additivity and homogeneity property must hold good. That means once again, I have to remember this one, that for input alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2, the corresponding output should be alpha 1 y1 plus alpha 2 y2. And it is not true only for two different inputs. So there could have been say n number of inputs. It's not that this law of superposition holds good only for two inputs like alpha 1 x1 plus alpha 2 x2. So you can apply, in general you can apply n number of inputs. That means it is true for this. If I apply alpha I xi for I is equal to 1 to n to a system which is a linear one, then the corresponding output should be given by I is equal to 1 to n alpha I yi. And if the system is composed of resistance only, then obviously this particular condition must hold good. So therefore, any circuit which is composed of a simple resistance then obviously the circuit is linear in nature. Now, after resistance, let us take a look at another circuit element, which is popularly employed in many of the electronic circuits. That's a capacitor. And now, let us consider a capacitor having a value, say, C. And you understand what is the relationship between the voltage and current for a capacitor. So the relationship is not a linear one, as far as this equation is concerned. You cannot write that Y is equal to mx. As you can write for a resistance, you cannot simply write that the voltage across the capacitor and the current that is flowing through the capacitor, that is linearly related like this. But what is the condition, or what is the formula? The current I can be represented by C dv dt, because you know the charge accumulated across the capacitor is given by C, the capacitance multiplied with the voltage across the capacitor, and the rate of change of the charge, that is dq dt, is given by C into dv dt. Assuming that the capacitor is constant, the value of the capacitance is constant, and the rate of charge flow is nothing but the current. So I is equal to C dv dt. So that is the formula. So the current and voltage, they follow this particular relationship, I is equal to C dv dt. Now the question is that although it seems that it's not a linear one, because we cannot write the input and output in the form of Y is equal to mx. So if you can write anything in the form of Y is equal to mx, then your understanding in coordinate geometry clearly dictates that it's a linear one, because it reflects the equation of a straight line. If the relationship between the input and the output, if I assume that the input to the system is x and the output of the system is y, then if y is equal to mx, if that is the relationship between the input and output, then obviously it's a linear one, because it satisfies the, or it shows you the equation of a straight line. That is true. But here you find that the equation is not that simple. Rather, it is given like I is equal to C dv dt. Or you can write that output is given by some constant multiplied with the derivative of the input. So now the question is whether this particular element C, whether this is a linear device or not. So whether it's a linear device or not, you have to give the answer in light of the superposition theorem, whether the additivity and whether the homogeneity, whether these two properties hold good or not, that you have to understand. Now, to give the answer, let us go back to the basics of derivative. What you have studied in your class 12 during understanding the concept of differentiation or derivative, the different properties of derivative. We know that ddt of v1 plus v2 is given by dv1 dt plus dv2 dt. That you know from your knowledge in differentiation. And also we know that ddt of some alpha times v is given by, where alpha is not a function of t, obviously it's a constant essentially, so it's given by alpha times dv dt. Now these are the two essential things that we have to verify, whether these two conditions hold good or not. We know that as far as the properties of differentiation is concerned, as far as the properties of derivative is concerned, ddt of v1 plus v2 is simply, where both of them, v1 and v2, they are function of time. So that can be decomposed into like dv1 dt plus dv2 dt. And ddt of alpha v is given by alpha times dv dt, where alpha is a constant, obviously, it's not a function of time. Now, since these two conditions hold good, so we can simply verify that the theory of superposition also holds good for a capacitor, for which the input and the output are related by means of some derivation. By means of some derivative function. So I is equal to C dv dt. That is fine. Moreover, if I go one step further, if I consider an inductor, so you'll find almost a similar thing. For an inductor, you have L over here, and you know that for an inductor, V is given by L di dt. from that, once again, if you want to represent this in terms of output and the corresponding, I think you can also write I is equal to one by L integration VDT. So moreover, this integration operation is also closed under this law of superposition. That means both the differentiation as well as integration, these two operations are closed as far as the additivity and homogeneity property of a system is concerned. So therefore, if we can consider these elements in isolation, resistance, capacitor, and inductor in isolation, then we'll find that this condition must hold good. That means this alpha one input alpha one x one plus alpha two x two, the corresponding output must be equal to alpha one y one plus alpha two y two. That is fine. Now under this basic assumptions or under this basic understanding, let us try to design the very simplest RC circuit, which is widely available in many of the electronic circuits for its various merits. Now the circuit looks something like that. And one thing you have to understand, one thing you have to identify whether the circuit itself is linear or not, because we have verified that the individual circuit elements are linear in nature, but obviously the arrangement is also important. Even if you have some linear devices in your circuit, but if they are connected in some different manner, then you find that the overall response between the output and input might not be linear in nature. So that we have to verify, because here we have considered that the entire circuit is composed of only one element, because V is my input and I is the corresponding output. So the circuit is composed of a single element like R, the circuit is composed of a single element like C, the circuit is composed of a single element like L. Now if I can design, or if I can develop a complicated circuit, a compound circuit consisting of these elements together, R, C, L together, then whether the overall circuit is linear or not, that you have to give the answer by finding out the relationship between the output and input. That means, once again, you have to search for this function. You have to search for this curly S, which maps the input X to some output Y. Now, if you find that this function itself is linear, then obviously you can say that, okay, the system itself, the circuit itself is linear. Otherwise, not. So, how can you write any? How can you write that this particular function S, as a function of X, is linear one? Then obviously, since you have some capacitor, since you have some inductor in my circuit, then obviously the relationship between the current and voltage must include some integration, must include some differentiation. Now, as long as you have some first order differential equation, then there is no problem. But if you have some second order differential equation, then obviously the situation will be complicated, and you cannot say directly that whether it's a linear one or not. But however, let us start our discussion with a simple first order circuit like this, which is composed of a single resistance and a single capacitor. So the circuit looks something like that. So you have R, you have C. This is the input. We are applying input over here, and this is the corresponding output. Now you have to verify whether the system is, whether the circuit itself is linear or not. So what is the circuit? How to understand the circuit? So circuit is this one, which is embedded into this dotted line. So now it is composed of two elements, resistance and capacitor. You have to identify the equation which relates the input and output, and that equation obviously is in the form of some differential equation, because the current and voltage relationship for capacitor is identified by some derivative. So therefore, we can simply write down the expression. So suppose the current that is flowing is let the current is represented by I, then you can simply write down the expression which relates the input to the output. So here we have represented that V in is the corresponding input being provided and V out is the corresponding output. So we have to individually observe each of the elements like R and C, and accordingly we can find out the expression for I. So we can write V in that is equal to R. So I think it will be better if I write in as a function of t, or rather I can simply write R into I plus this voltage, that is V out. Now I can simply write V in is equal to R into I plus V out. That is one option. Otherwise, in terms of current also, I can also write down the expression. So already have seen that I is equal to C dV dt. For any capacitor, the relationship between the current and the voltage is given by I is equal to C dV dt. That was the relationship. The current I is equal to C dV dt. So therefore, what is that voltage? So that voltage is nothing but the voltage across the capacitor. So I can write I is equal to C dV out dt. So instead of writing simply V out, I can write V out as 1 by C integration I dt. So V out is given by 1 by C integration I dt. So let me just change the color. One by C integration I dt. So you must appreciate that I is a function of time. So that's why it will be better if I write as a function of t like this. So let it be like V in as a function of t is equal to R I as a function of t plus 1 by C integration I as a function of t dt. Now you can once again represent this expression in the form of differential equation just by differentiating the left hand side and the right hand side with respect to t. So if you differentiate this entire expression with respect to t, what you are getting, you'll be getting like dv in t dt is equal to R dit dt plus it by C. It by C. So that is the expression which relates the input to the output current. So it is the current that is flowing through the circuit and V int is the input. So ultimately this expression can be represented by means of a linear differential equation. It's a linear one because the highest degree of derivative is 1 over here. You don't find that d square I dt square, or you don't find dI dt whole square like this. So both the order and the degree is 1 in this particular expression. You find that dv in dt is equal to R dI dt plus it upon C. So it's a linear differential equation. Now as long as the relationship between the input and the output, remember here output is the current, it is the output current, and v in t is the input voltage. Because if you know it, then you can easily calculate v out as 1 by C integration of it dt. So I can understand that IT is the current, that is the output current, and because of the corresponding input Vin. So Vin is the stimulus being provided to the circuit, and the corresponding response is obtained in the form of IT. And if you want to represent in the form of V out, then it can be represented like 1 upon C integration of IT dt. So therefore, IT is the output quantity or output component output signal, and VNT is the input signal. So this input and output, they are related by means of this linear differential equation. DVNT dt is equal to R di dt plus IT by C. So that is the expression. And since it's a linear differential equation, so the entire circuit gives you some linear response or linear behavior. Now, before going into the detailed mathematical calculation of the circuit, let us try to understand what kind of operation being fabricated or being improvised by this particular circuit. As you know, a resistance is purely a frequency insensitive device. What do you mean by frequency insensitive device? Because whenever we have some resistance, and if the current and voltage is given by the I and V for across any resistance, I mean, if I have a resistance R, and if the current that is flowing through the resistance is I, and if the voltage across the two terminals, let it be V, then you know that V is equal to R into I. V is equal to R into I. That is true for any frequency. Even if you provide some sinusoidal signal, even if you provide some say some triangular waveform, even if you provide some constant DC signal, the relationship always holds good as far as the Ohm's law is concerned. V is equal to R into I. That must hold good. That is fine, because the resistance, in the expression of the resistance, you don't find any frequency element over here. However, on the other hand, if I just consider a capacitor whose value is C, then the reactance provided by the capacitor, as you know, the reactance provided by the capacitor XC is given by 1 upon J omega C, where omega is equal to twice pi F, that is angular frequency, that is equal to 1 by J twice pi FC. Now here you find this term is coming, that is frequency. Frequency is coming in the expression of the reactance. Frequency is coming, and that is coming in the denominator. Now, what is the implication of having a frequency in the denominator? It means that whenever the frequency operation is very small, that means it's like few tens of hertz, or even it's a DC signal, then the reactance provided by the capacitor is becoming infinite. Because if F is equal to zero, if you put the value of F equal to zero, then the corresponding value of reactance XC is equal to infinite. Now, as you increase the frequency, that means if you increase F, that means the value of the reactance goes down. Therefore, I may consider two extreme conditions. One condition is when F is equal to zero, we are applying some DC signal for which the frequency operation is equal to zero, or very slowly varying signal, slowly varying AC signal. Then the reactance provided by the capacitor is very large. Ideally, you can consider to be infinite. Now, if you go on increasing the signal frequency from a few hertz to say few kilohertz, and kilohertz to megahertz, megahertz to gigahertz, then what happens? As the frequency operation increases, then the reactance provided by the capacitor is reducing. And for a very high value of the frequency, if you consider frequency value to be say in the order of few gigahertz or terahertz, then we can think that the reactance provided by this capacitor is becoming zero, because if it is very large, for a considerable value of C capacitance, the X of C, that is the reactance provided by the capacitor, will become zero. That means here, for any capacitor, the reactance is not constant throughout. It heavily depends upon the frequency of operation. For a resistance, it is always constant, that is R. However, for the capacitor, although it's a function of capacitor, but it is not fixed. It is inversely varying with the frequency of operation. Now, in light of this discussion, let us try to understand what is there, what is the operation being performed by this circuit. Now, as you can see over here, whenever the frequency, suppose I am just changing the input signal frequency, suppose I am just changing the F value, suppose I am having a sinusoidal signal over here, and for which the frequency of the sinusoidal signal is increased from very small value, from few hertz to say few megahertz or gigahertz. Now, when the frequency is very small, then what will happen? This capacitor will become open circuited, because if it's very small, then the reactance provided by the capacitor will be infinite, and you can think that these two terminals they are not connected. So the capacitor is providing very high value of reactance to the circuit itself, and as a matter of fact, whatever be the input signal you are applying over here, the same will be obtained over here, because there is no flow of current, because the reactance provided by the capacitor is very large and the circuit is not complete, right? So Vin will be equal to V out when the input is very small. I mean, input frequency is very small. Now, when you go on increasing the input frequency, then what happens? From this infinite value of the reactance from open circuit, then gradually there will be some finite value of the capacitance, because as you increase the value of F, then the reactance of the capacitor will be reducing to some extent. And as you go on increasing the frequency, what happens? Then ultimately, the reactance provided by the capacitor will be reduced. And ultimately, for a very high value of the frequency, say a few gigahertz or a few terahertz, then you find that the reactance provided by the capacitor will be equal to zero. And then if the reactance is equal to zero, then these two terminals, they are basically shorted. So initially, they were open circuited. So that means there was no connection between them. So Vin was equal to V out. And gradually, when you go on increasing the frequency to a very large value, then these two terminals, they are essentially short circuited. So then the output drops to zero. So initially, the output was equal to V in, V out was equal to V in for a very small value of the frequency. And when the input frequency is very large, then the output voltage is becoming zero. So therefore, the circuit performs a typical behavior. For very high value of the frequency, the output voltage is becoming zero. And for very low value of the frequency, the output voltage just follows the input voltage. And it resembles the operation of a filter circuit. What type of filter circuit it is? It is nothing but a low pass filter. Because as you know, for a low pass filter, it will only pass the low frequency component. However, as you increase the frequency beyond a certain limit, then the attenuation provided by the circuit increases, the gain reduces, and ultimately, for a very high value of the frequency, the gain drops to zero, and ultimately, the operation of the circuit is off. So here you can say that this entire thing, this entire RC circuit gives rise to a simple low-pass filter. Now, let us try to do some mathematics over here so that you can find out the expression for the current and voltage in terms of, okay, let me do one thing. Just a minute. Okay, so we have this circuit, and we have observed that qualitatively, we have observed that this circuit is nothing but a low pass filter. So qualitatively, we have already verified that it's nothing but a low pass filter. So this one is R, this one is C, V in between this two terminal and V out. Now, whenever you have got a circuit, then sometimes it is very essential to identify the frequency response of the circuit. So what do you mean by the frequency response of a circuit? By the term frequency response, we mean to say that how does the circuit behave whenever the input frequency varies, and whatever be the corresponding output voltage. For example, we have some input voltage over here, And suppose I do not know what are the defined frequency components present in the signal itself. And accordingly, I have to observe the corresponding the frequency components present in the output side. So the idea is to provide a particular type of signal which contains all the frequencies in equal proportion. And let us try to observe how does the circuit behave accordingly. What we have analyzed few minutes back by means of this circuit is that it gives rise to a low pass behavior. That means if the frequency operation is very small, then the output is equal to input, and when the frequency is very large, then the output is becoming zero. That is one kind of analysis that we have already made. But mathematically, whenever we would like to find out the frequency response of the circuit, then we must want to know how about the frequency behavior or frequency response of the circuit, of the output, gets affected, although at the input side, we are providing the signal having all the frequency components in equal proportion. That means at the input side, we are providing a fair input which contains all the frequencies in equal proportion. And if the circuit itself is a low pass one, then obviously it will just pass the low frequency component and it will suppress the high frequency component. So at the input side, we are providing a fair input which contains all the frequency components in equal proportion. So first of all, you have to identify that frequency, that particular signal which contains all the frequencies in equal proportion. And the only signal that is available in the world which is having all the frequency components in equal proportion is nothing but an impulse function, a delta function. As you know, if you just find out the Fourier transform of delta function, Laplace transform of delta function, then you'll find that it's a constant. So delta function, delta t, is the only signal available for which the frequency response is becoming constant. That means if I have a delta function at the input side, if I have a delta function, you know that delta t, and if I observe the delta function in the frequency domain, so this is the frequency domain. So now, if you observe this delta function in the frequency domain, you'll find that all the frequency components are present in equal proportion. So delta t will exist only for a shorter period of time in the time domain. It exists only for t is equal to zero. So it's a time limited signal, but band unlimited one. So that is the response. So that is the power spectral density of delta function, delta t. It's constant. That means throughout, for all frequency from minus to plus infinity, the delta function is having the presence, the occurrence of all the frequency components and with equal proportion. This equal proportion is also important, that all the frequency components from minus infinity to plus infinity, all the frequency components are present with equal proportion within the delta function delta t. Now, obviously, to characterize any circuit mathematically, to analyze any circuit mathematically, whether it's a low pass filter or band pass filter, band stop filter or high pass filter, the idea is to excite the circuit, stimulate the circuit by means of a fair and so I think that is let me write PSD power spectral density. So the idea is whenever we would like to know the behavior, the frequency characteristics of any circuit, then conceptually, we have to excite the circuit by means of a signal which is fair in nature. That means which contains all the frequency components in equal proportion. So unbiased. So this particular signal is unbiased as far as the frequency content is concerned, because it contains all the frequency component. Now let us, so now by applying this delta t function, now whenever we apply delta t, that means whenever my Vin is equal to delta t, that means I am feeding all the frequency components in equal proportion to the system itself, this RC combination, this circuit itself. And let us check how does the circuit behave, because we have fed all the frequency components in equal proportion. Now if the circuit itself is a low pass one, then obviously it will pass only the high frequency, low frequency component will suppress the higher one, higher frequency components. On the other hand, if the circuit is a high pass filter, then it will pass only the higher frequency component, and accordingly the lower frequency components will be suppressed. And if it's a band pass filter, then obviously a band of frequency will be allowed to pass and the other will not be allowed to pass, and accordingly we can have the different filter configuration, low pass, high pass, band stop, notch filter. So there could have been different types of filter. So with this understanding, let us try to derive the expression for this. And this expression is represented by means of in the Laplace domain, in the Laplace domain or in the S domain, because whenever we do have some differential equation in the natural time domain, then obviously if we go into the Laplace domain, in the transform domain, then the differential equation will become a simply algebraic equation. So it will be easier for computation. So in the Laplace domain, so this R is, so that is the Laplace domain. So R will be there as R, and this C in the Laplace domain, this C is given by 1 upon CS. That is the reactance provided by the capacitor, that is 1 upon CS. And then let us try to understand what is the expression for gain in the Laplace domain or in the transform domain. So the expression for the gain, if I write this as A of S in the Laplace domain, that is nothing but V out S upon V in S. I am just going into the Laplace domain. V out S by V in S. So now each of these two elements are being modeled by means of two reactances. R is being modeled by simply R, and C is being modeled by means of 1 upon CS. Now we have two different impedance. One is R, second one is 1 upon CS. Now you apply the V in S here and you get V out S here. Then what is the relationship between V out and V in? So you can find that this relationship is given by 1 upon CS, simple voltage divider law, 1 upon CS divided by R plus 1 upon CS. So if you multiply with CS, then it will become 1 by 1 plus SRC. 1 by 1 plus SRC. That is the expression for AS, that is V out S by V in S. Now, if delta T is the input, if delta T is equal to your V in, if delta T is equal to V in T, then the corresponding V in S is nothing but the Laplace transform delta T, and that is equal to constant, that is 1. Laplace transform delta function is equal to 1. So V in S will become simply 1. So ultimately, your V out S is given by 1 by 1 plus SRC. Now, if we want to represent by means of frequency of omega, then it is given by 1 by 1 plus J omega RC. that is equal to 1 by 1 plus j twice pi f rc, where f is the hertz frequency and omega is the angular frequency, as you know. So a of omega is ultimately given by 1 by 1 plus j twice by f rc. Then what about the gain? So as you understand, this expression contains some magnitude, and as well as it will contain some phase as well, because of the presence of this capacitor. Had there been only resistance, then there will be no question of phase reverse or phase change, because for simple resistive element there is no phase difference, phase lead or phase lag. But whenever you have some capacitor, whenever you have some inductor in the circuit, then obviously the notion of phase lag or phase lead will take into place. So what will be the expression for mod of A? So mod of A as a function of omega is given by, you have in the numerator you have 1, and in the denominator you have 1 plus j twice pi f r c. Instead of writing omega, I think I can also write, instead of omega, I can also write like f, so that you can relate with the hertz frequency. So 1 by 1 plus j twice pi f r c. So 1 plus twice pi f r c whole square. Now from this expression, it is also clear that if f is equal to 0, then obviously f is equal to 1, and if f is very large, then this inter part is becoming very, very large with respect to 1, and ultimately this f will becoming 0. So it gives rise to the notion of a low pass filter, because for a very low frequency the gain is pretty large, and as you increase the frequency operation, the gain is reducing, and for a very high value of the frequency, the gain will become 0. Now that is pertinent from the mathematical analysis as well. Now if I would like to draw this variation of AF with respect to the frequency, so this is AF, this is AF. Now you find that the peak of the AF, or AF max, mod AF max, that is becoming 1 when F is equal to 0, or F is very small. And there is a term popularly employed in the field of circuits and systems, which is known as the 3 dB cutoff frequency, or half power point. What is meant by that? Now when AF max is equal to 1, as far as the absolute value is concerned, then in the dB scale, decibel scale, this is equivalent to 0 dB. How to get the value of this decibel from the absolute value? It's nothing but you have to take the 20 log 10 of this entire thing. 20 log 10 of entire thing will give you 0 dB, because 20 log 10 of 1 will give you 0 dB. So 1 means 0 dB. Now whenever we talk about a half power point or half power frequency point, that means square of this, square of this mod AF will become half. Or in other words, mod AF will become 1 upon root 2 at a particular frequency, and that particular frequency is known as the half power frequency. So this is given by 1 plus twice pi f r c whole square. Let me call this frequency to be, say, let it be f 1. So if you equate, then you find that 2 pi f 1 r c whole square plus 1 is equal to 2 or 2 pi f1 r c. Is equal to 1. From that we find f1 is equal to 1 by 2 pi rc, or if you write in terms of the angular frequency, omega 1, which is equal to twice pi f1, that is given by 1 upon rc. So at this particular frequency f1, which is given by 1 by twice pi rc, the gain drops to 70.7%, 0.707 of the peak, because 1 upon root 2 is equal to 0.707. So the peak is obtained at, so the peak is obtained at 1 or 0 dB. So the response looks something like that. It's a monotonically decreasing function. Suppose this is equal to 1, then we can mark this point to be 0.707. Suppose this point is 0.7. This point is 0.7. And this one is obtained at a frequency f1. F1. This is also called a 3 dB frequency, 3 dB cutoff frequency, because if you take 20 log 10 base 1 upon root 2, then the value is becoming minus 3 dB. So 20 log 10 base 1 upon root 2. To calculate this value, it is coming like minus 3 dB. So here the gain was 1, that is 0 dB, and here the gain is minus 3 dB. That means there is a 3 dB fall, and whenever the gain falls by an amount of 3 dB, that point is considered to be the cutoff frequency, and this cutoff frequency is being represented by F1. Now for a low pass filter, this cutoff frequency is known as the higher cutoff frequency, because there is no lower cutoff frequency. Starting from the 0 Hz, all the frequency will be passed, but there is a higher cutoff, there is a higher bound over and above the voltage gain drops significantly. And if the difference is more than 3 dB, then we can demarcate that point to be the beginning of the stop band for any filter. So this F1 is known to be the higher cutoff frequency. So instead of writing F1, one can also write like F of H, because this is given by the higher cutoff frequency, F of H. F of H. So F of H is known as the higher cutoff frequency here for a low pass filter. So F of H is known as the higher cutoff frequency. Higher cutoff frequency. So what we have done in this particular experiment, we have provided at the input to the system a signal which contains all the frequency in equal component. I mean, all the frequency components with equal proportion. That was a delta function, delta t. So the excitation, what you provided over here, the excitation was uniform as far as their frequency behavior is concerned, because it contains all the frequency components. Now, it is the, so we did not provide any bias over here. So my input was fair and unbiased. The input was fair and unbiased as far as the frequency characteristics is concerned. However, whenever we observe the output response resulting from this particular circuit, we find that the output does not favor all the frequency components equally. Rather, whenever the frequency component is small, in particular, whenever the frequency component is less than FH, the higher cutoff frequency, then the gain is sufficiently large And if the frequency component, if the frequency is larger or higher than the value of FH, then the gain drops significantly, and we may consider that the circuit, as shown in this particular example, is a perfect one for exhibiting the low pass behavior. So we did not provide or we did not create any nuisance at the input side. We have provided all the frequency components in equal proportion. So all the higher frequency components beyond FH, so all the frequency components from starting from 0 hertz to few gigahertz or terahertz, so all the frequency components, ideally, we have provided all of them in equal proportion at the input side. But because of the characteristics of the circuit itself, the higher frequency components got suppressed. However, the lower frequency component is retained. So that is the property of the low pass filter. So low pass filter is simply obtained by means of this particular RC circuit. Now, instead of providing some delta T, now we can provide different input excitation. So the most familiar one or most familiar input excitation is a simple step function, that is UT. You can also provide some pulse waveform. You can also provide some rectangular, the square waveform, or you can also observe the behavior of the circuit whenever we have some ramp function or triangular waveform. So accordingly, the behavior of the circuit will be different. But whenever we provide the delta function, which is an ideal one as far as its frequency characteristics is concerned, we can characterize the system property. Because in order to characterize something, you have to be unbiased. And this unbiased experiment has been carried out by providing a delta function. Apart from delta function, there could have been plenty of signal that is available, and you can also excite your circuit with each of this signal, like simple step function, then you have pulse waveform, then you have some square waveforms, you can have some angular waveforms, some sawtooth waveform, ramp function. So there are plenty of functions available for which you can just observe how does the circuit behave, what is the output for the circuit, that is fine. But whenever to observe the circuit itself, to observe the behavior of the circuit itself, first of all, you have to characterize the circuit. That is very important. Whenever you design some instrument, in order to allow those instruments to measure something, first of all, you need to calibrate the instrument. First of all, you have to standardize the instrument. First of all, you have to characterize the instrument. Similarly, here also, before applying the different types of input like step, pulse, rectangular, and sawtooth waveform, or triangular waveform, first of all, our first objective for any circuit is to characterize the system as far as the frequency response is concerned. So this characterization has been accomplished by providing a delta function at the input. And what we have observed is the circuit itself here shows you the behavior of a low-pass nature. That means it will preserve the low-frequency component and it will suppress the high-frequency component. Now in the next lecture, I will once again analyze this particular circuit by providing different such inputs like unit step function, like pulse waveform, like rectangular waveform, square waveform, triangular waveform, and so on and so forth. And accordingly, you have to observe how does the behavior, how does the output of the circuit get affected with each of the inputs and with the components of the circuit itself. Now here we have only two components to start with. We have only two components. One is the resistance R and second is the capacitance C. That is R and C, and this RC combination and RC product will play a vital role in analyzing the behavior of the circuit, and that we will be discussing in the next class. Now in this class, what we have done is that we have characterized the simple RC circuit by means of its frequency behavior, and ultimately we have established that a simple RC circuit which looks something like that is nothing but a low pass filter which will allow the low frequency component and suppress the high frequency component, and accordingly we have defined one higher cutoff frequency pertaining to the low pass behavior, and this higher cutoff frequency is given by 1 pi twice pi RC. So therefore, if the RC product R and C, if that value is large, then obviously the higher cutoff frequency will be small, because F1 and so I should write over here FH, so that it is becoming, so it's omega H, so higher cutoff frequency, so that it is consistent. So what we find is FH, the higher cutoff frequency, is inversely proportional to RC product, is inversely proportional to R into C. So as you increase the R and C product, then obviously this higher cutoff frequency will be reduced, and vice versa. So for higher value of RC, FH will be shifted towards this side, and for lower value of RC, the FH will be shifted to that side. So that is the only observation what you can find from here, is that you can you cannot change the characteristics. The characteristics will be a low pass nature, but what you can do is you can simply change the this particular frequency. So this frequency, I mean the higher cutoff frequency, can be tuned, and that tuning is obtained by means of this RC product, and that happens reciprocally as far as the value of FH and RC is concerned. So with this, I would like to conclude this discussion, the fundamental elementary discussion about the RC circuit. And in the next class, I'll be talking about the response, the excitation, or the output of the circuit, of this simple RC circuit, whenever there are different types of stimulus. As I already mentioned, different types of input signal like step function, ramp function, exponential function, and so on. And accordingly, we will analyze the behavior of the circuit.